seek to be a blessing to you. We love you and praise you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
All right.
Well, a few things. First of all, thank you for supporting my study week this past week. I studied a lot. And Carrie and the kids would come home, and I'd be kind of like a little bit of the drool thing going on. And it is weird. I really worked my brain harder than I have in a while. But it was awesome. Yes.
It shows.
It shows. I had some cleaning water. It's amazing. But, yeah. And but don't worry, because I'm not preaching today. I have a few people say, oh, are you preaching? And no, Dave, is that okay? So I want to clear that up right away. Yeah, I appreciate Dave jumping in and covering our pulpit the last couple of weeks. It's been a great couple of weeks for me, so I appreciate that. Also want to say I really appreciate Dave. We had our elder retreat yesterday morning, and really a good time together. And as we had recently elected and ordained two new elders in the mix, and that was just so much fun to have us all together. And Dave came and presented on a number of things for us, and everybody, I got emails and texts, and, oh, that was awesome, that was great. So another reason to just appreciate my brother. So how was Bunko? Awesome. Who won? Yeah, okay.
We should have won.
Okay, so yeah, with Bunko, there's not like one winner, right? There's like all these weird varieties of winning. So people could lose. People just pull on, you know what? I lost. Okay, well, during prayer time, we'll have a special prayer. Okay, good. But yeah, I heard that was good. And I didn't expect to see the Johnsons here, but wow.
Yeah.
Yeah. After Rick just blew up his leg, literally, and they still decided they'd host the party last night. So kudos to them and our prayers need to continue to be with Rick and Diane. I mean, you don't know how that goes. So but good. I'm glad. I'm glad that was great. And a good shower yesterday from what I hear. Busy day yesterday. Thank you to all who were showing their love and support for St. Civitas and Jeremy and Kaya and the upcoming little one. So that was wonderful. Okay, we've got a few things coming up in our schedule. And starting with tonight, we have a youth night tonight. So that is a happy and exciting thing. We've got some good things planned. Also, in our elders, we don't need reminding because we were just talking about it yesterday, but we do have our elder meeting on Wednesday at 6. Also on Wednesday is the men's lunch at Bocce's. And Ron mentioned to me, I goofed it up and put Monday the last couple of bulletins. So big apologies for that, especially if you had a very lonely lunch at Bocce's. But Wednesday, noon, Bocce's, guys. Awesome. Okay. Also, big deal, Thursday. Notice on Thursday, 6:30 p.m., the Abide Project Planning Meeting. We've been talking about this, and there's a little description on the other under the announcements. We did a good 12-week run of the Abide Project. I've gotten some of the evaluation forms in. I'd love to get more in if you can get them to me. But by and large, positive and some interest in continuing doing more of the Abide, some interest in other things. So that's what Thursday night's about. If you were involved with the Abide project and want to kind of help talk about it, evaluate it, but also do some planning for what's to come, please, please be there Thursday night. If you, I had some of the initial forms for the Abide project said, ooh, I can't right now, but I'd be interested in another time. If that's you, please do come out and hear what we're going to pull together. And knowing that you would be interested in it, would actually help. So Thursday night, 6:30, we're going to talk about the Abide Project. We're going to talk about small groups. It's a good meeting to attend. Here, thank you. Actually, Jacobs, are you guys good for hosting? It's Thursday. No, breakfast, we can do whatever, but we'll have 3 hours together talking about deacons and what we're going to tackle this year. So all deacons, please be there. And then, okay, so for next Sunday, it says youth night. No, scratch that out. A couple other things under announcements. One of them has to do with Wayne's Bible study. So Carrie.
Good morning. We have the new books for the women's Bible studies. We're doing Priscilla Schreiner's The Armor of God. We've done a few of her studies and we love them. I know we played a promo video a few weeks back. The study starts on the 21st, and I have the books available for you now. You can get them. Please do not give me any money now. We're going to collect money on the first day of the study so it can be organized and we'll collect it. So, but take a book now so you can start reading it. You can start it if you want to. I did order 10 extras last study. Every extra book was gone before the study even began. So if you have a friend, if you want a book, please take a book for your friend. And if you need scholarship money, just let me know that privately. We have money. We don't want any woman to not have a book that would like a book. The books are great. I already watched the first video and began reading the book, and it was absolutely inspiring. So I'm really excited for this. We have Tyler here. Please invite a friend. I think there's some flyers out. If not, I'll put some more out for all of us. So the first study is the 21st, and the books will be available today in Fellowship Hall. And if you ordered one, make sure you communicate with me if you take one so I can check your name off. And if you want one for a friend, I'll write your name on the list so we can keep track of the extra books. So no one that ordered one doesn't get one. But we're excited for the study, so please join us. The first week on the 21st, we'll just go straight to the lecture at 4 o'clock. So thank you.
All right, good. And then the last thing I've got here, we've mentioned this a few times, and just seeing if we want to build a team to provide one lunch for the teachers and staff at the elementary school. It's kind of a nice outreach deal. So if you would be interested in being a part of that little lunch-making team, let us know. If we don't get a good enough team, we'll just say we can't do it now because we don't want to put all that on one or two people, so or three. But if you are interested, please let us know and then we can start getting that officially set up. All right? Any other announcements for us that...
Thank you. Again, for this time we get together. I know it's so good for me just to take these few hours on a Sunday where we can be together, all praising your name together, Lord. I pray that this is a time that we can glorify you and that you can fill our spirits and that we may grow in this time, Lord.
This is the air I breathe.
thank you, Lord, again for this time. Prepare our hearts to hear your word. Amen.
If we got any kids that are going off to Sunday school, now is the time. Go for it.
Into my sophomore year of high school. months into that, my best friend at the time, who was a senior in high school and a Christian, played a big part in me coming to know Christ, Cal. He said to me one day, he said, "Dave, I dare you to make a commitment to read your Bible every day for the rest of your life." And at the age of 16 and a half, I, you know, probably it was just my pride. I said, "Well, I can do that," you know. And so I took him up on that. And for the last 43 years, I mean, there have been days when I have not read my Bible. But in those 43 years, almost every day, I've read my Bible. In mm-hmm. fact, there was a stretch of time where for 3 years, isn't that just like crazy? I mean, even I look back and I say, that's crazy. You know? When you are a Christian long enough and you read your Bible long enough, over time you begin to develop favorite characters in the Bible. You might even develop favorite books in the Bible that are yours. You know what I mean? You know, for me, for example, in the New Testament, you know, one of my favorite New Testament books is the book of Philippians. Mm-hmm. I just love that book. And you know, what was it? It was last year that Ellen and I here at Hope talked through the book of Philippians. Mm-hmm. When I'm thinking about the Old Testament, easily, it's kind of like part two and part one and part two. Mm-hmm. But the book in the Old Testament that I think is my favorite is the book or the pair First and Second Samuel. It's always just been a favorite of mine. And so my normal routine is when I'm meditating on the scriptures during a quiet time, you know, I'll spend like quite some time in like, recently I've been mostly in the New Testament. And so I've kind of wrapped up my readings and I said, what do I want to read next? And I realized I haven't been in First and Second Samuel for a long time. So I want to go back there, you know. And so that's where I've been for a while, and I'm going to share with you some things that I've gotten out of that. Let me give you a little bit of a background, a context of the book of 1 and 2 Samuel, and more importantly, the book of 1 Samuel. In 1 Samuel, we are introduced to basically these three main characters. We've got Samuel, the prophet, who actually was the last of a group, a string of leaders called the judges. Before Israel was ruled by kings, they were led by people called judges. And in fact, it was a group of men, and there was one woman who was a judge in the Old Testament. That's very, very interesting. But these were men and women who were kind of prophets, spiritual leaders. Major decisions were made by them. They would get direction from God. They oftentimes would lead Israel in battle. And that's how Israel got the job done. The last judge and prophet was Samuel. So we're introduced to Samuel. Then we're introduced to Saul, the very first king of Israel. And then we're introduced to, who is probably one of the favorite Bible characters of so many Christians, David, the man who was said to be the man after God's own heart. And even though he was far from perfect, and we'll touch upon this towards the end of my talk today, but it would be David and his lineage through which Jesus the Messiah would come. Okay? And so, with that background, could you turn in your Bibles to Samuel, 1 Samuel, chapter 13. Your Bibles in front if you didn't bring yours today. It's okay here if you use an electronic device for your Bible. I do. And I always worry if during Brian's sermon someone's thinking I'm texting somebody. I feel like I need to every once in a while go, no, Bible. And then other times I'm texting someone. Now let me give you just a few things that led up to the story we're going to look at in 1 Samuel chapter 13. A few chapters earlier, Eli was the high priest. He's running things. He has two sons that are standing to inherit the priesthood. These were not good boys. They were corrupt. They had led the priesthood into a corruption. They were basically pilfering and stealing things. They became very immoral, where they were taking advantage of women who were in the ministry, serving in the temple, and they're just bad boys. And for whatever reason, Eli wasn't doing anything about it. I don't know if it was just because he was trying to look the other way, because they were his kids. There's reason to believe that Eli was kind of profiting a little bit on the side from the actions of his boys. And so the time comes where, you know, basically what God says is, I got to get rid of this whole priesthood and start all over, and I'm going to kill these guys. Which is indeed, you know, kind of what happens. And but you know, while that's happening, you know, fast forward a little bit, you know, so what happens is we got Hannah, who is the mother of Samuel. She's a woman. She hasn't been able to have a child. She says, God, if you give me a boy, I'll dedicate him to the ministry the rest of his life. So much to her surprise, she becomes pregnant. True to her word, she dedicates this boy, drops the boy off with Eli, okay, the high priest. He hasn't been taken out of office yet. And he raises him, and of course there's this exciting story where here's this little boy serving in the temple, you know, camping out in the temple, and in the middle of the night he hears a voice saying, Samuel, Samuel. You know, he thinks it's Eli calling him, you know, and he rushes in, yeah, what do you want? It's not me, go back to bed. And so he goes back home, and eventually God reveals himself to young Samuel. Eli and his leadership team is destroyed. Samuel comes on the scene. And so there's becomes this time now, and Samuel is the one who sets Saul apart as king. But before that, here's the interesting thing. The people, they come up to Samuel. Now remember, prior to this, they didn't have a king. They had judges. They come up and say, we want a king. All the other nations have a king. We want to have a king. Samuel says, you don't want to have a king. Yeah, we want to have a king. You don't want to have a king. Yeah, we want to have a king. Everybody else has a king. He says, you don't know what you're asking for. You know, if you have a king, he's going to abuse you and control you, and you think you have it bad now, you're going to have it even worse under a king. But the people keep pressing him, and so what happens is, you know, Samuel says to God, what am I supposed to do here? The people keep saying they want a king. They want to be like all the other nations around them. And so God finally says, you know what, give them a king. I'm going to give them what they want. You know, and so Saul becomes king, and because of all this pressure. When I was thinking about this and reading this back in December, I think I was in 1 Samuel. I'm in 2 Samuel now. But when I was in 1 Samuel, I began to think how, you know, here are the people, you know, every other nation has a king. We want to be like the other nations. And I began to think that, you know, really, isn't there a part of us all that wants to be like everybody else? I mean, we want to fit in. We want to be popular. You know, we don't want to seem like, you know, weirdos or things like that. And so, you know, we want to be like everyone else. But the problem is we really have called to be different. We're supposed to be different, not weirdos. Have you ever known a weirdo Christian? Not at this church, but I mean, you know, it's just we've been called to be, you know, different. We've been called actually to be like Jesus. And if you try to be like Jesus just going to make you different than so many of the people that surround us and in the world. And I began to think that, you know, if I had nothing more than the Gospels, nothing more than the life of Jesus to study, I would need nothing more to correctly model what a Christian is supposed to be. Mm-hmm. Does a Christian need more than the Gospels? Of course we do. But, you know, I'm supposed to be like Jesus. On my small church pastor group page that I have, because I moderate a large group of pastors online, I made that statement, and one pastor called and added to it, and he said, well, just think, if we only had the Sermon on the Mount, if that's all we had to live by, you know, we would know enough to be and represent, you know, Jesus. And so the people insisted on a king, and despite Samuel's warning, Saul is chosen, and almost immediately Saul begins to get into trouble. Okay, so having said that, we're at 1 Samuel chapter 13. I'm going to read a portion of this. I'm reading out of I don't know, I think it's NIV. It could be the American Standard, but I don't know. Here we go. Saul was 30 years old when he began to reign, and he reigned 42 years over Israel. That's a long time. Now Saul chose for himself 3,000 men of Israel, of which 2,000 were with Saul in Michmash, which is just a funny place to live anyways, and in the hill country of Bethel, while 1,000 were with Jonathan. Jonathan was one of Saul's sons. He had three sons, and Jonathan was the oldest, and if you continue to read on into the story, Jonathan will go on to become best friends with David. They really love each other. They're a great example of brotherly commitment and things like that. So we've got 1,000 troops with Jonathan at Gibeah Benjamin. But he went away, but he sent away the rest of the people, each to his tent. Jonathan smote the garrison of the Philistines that were in Geba, and the Philistines heard of it. Then Saul blew the trumpet throughout the land, saying, "Let the Hebrews hear." And all Israel heard the news that Saul had smitten the garrison of the Philistines, and also that Israel had become odious to the Philistines. The people were then summoned to Saul at Gilgal, verse 5. Now the Philistines assembled. Okay, so you got the Philistines, and they got all these different tribes, and there had been kind of like this kind of victory that Israel had in, this one battle had victory. Now the word reaches the whole rest of the Philistines. And they decide, we are going to amass in full force in retaliation. Now the Philistines assembled to fight with Israel 30,000 chariots. What? Saul had 3,000, Jonathan had 1,000 or something like that. I mean, okay, so get the ratios here. 30,000 chariots, 6,000 horsemen, and people like the sand, which is on the seashore in abundance. And they came up and camped in Michmash, east of Beth-Aven. When the men of Israel saw that they were in a strait, for the people were hard-pressed, they started hiding in caves, thickets, cliffs, cellars, and in pits. Also, some of the Hebrews crossed the Jordan into the land of Gad and Gilead. But as for Saul, he was still in Gilgal, and all the people followed him, trembling. Okay, so you're catching the situation here. Verse 8. Now he waited 7 days according to the appointed time set by Samuel. Pause there. You go back to 1 Samuel chapter 10. And in chapter 10, anticipating this big battle, of which Israel is going to be greatly outnumbered, Samuel, the prophet, says to Saul, okay, get everybody together, but I don't want you to do anything. I want you to wait for 7 days until I show up. I'll come on the scene. I'll offer the sacrifices and the offerings. We'll get God on our side, and then you can go into battle. Okay, so that's what's being referred to here. When he waited 7 days according to the appointed time set by Samuel, but Samuel did not come to Gilgal. And the people were scattering from him. So Saul said, bring to me the burnt offerings and the peace offerings. And he offered the burnt offerings. Now, you don't do that back in that culture. You just don't do that. We say, what's the big deal? It's a good thing to offer sacrifices. He did a good. No. Only the priest does that. Samuel said, I'm going to come. I'll offer those sacrifices. You don't do that unless you're a priest. And he offered the burnt offerings. Now, wouldn't you guess? As soon as he finished offering the burnt offerings, behold, Samuel came. And Saul went out to meet him and to greet him. But Samuel said, what have you done? And Saul said, well, because I saw that the people were scattering from me and that you didn't come in the appointed days and the Philistines were assembling at Mishmash, therefore I said, now the Philistines will come down against me at Gilgal. I have not asked the Lord's favor. So I forced myself. Yeah, that's right. I forced myself and offered the burnt offering. Samuel said to Saul, you have acted foolish. You've not kept the commandment of the Lord your God, which he commanded you. For now the Lord would have established your kingdom over Israel forever. But now instead your kingdom shall not endure. The Lord has sought out for himself a man after his own heart, talking about David. And the Lord has appointed him as ruler over his people because you have not kept what the Lord commanded you. So everything is unraveling before Saul's eyes, and he felt like he had to take matters into his own hands, and because of this, it cost him and his descendants the kingdom of God forever. Now, I don't know about you, but this story, it's never quite seemed fair to me. But I really don't know what was going on in Saul's heart. I mean, was he totally sincere? I mean, as that 7-day waiting period ticked away, was he becoming increasingly patient? You know, as he saw not only his enemies getting closer and closer, but the people started deserting him. A portion of his soldiers began to leave him. When we're under pressure, the one who was under pressure here, but you know, pressure can do that to us. It can either bring out good or it can bring out bad. Somebody said that when squeezed, whatever is in a person will come out of a person. And that's true. When I was reading and thinking on this passage myself, I couldn't help but think that, you know, how often do I take matters into my own hands when things seem to be unraveling around me? How often, when under pressure, do I allow my flesh, that bad part of me, to come out? How often do I miss the blessing and provision of God because I was not willing or could not wait? I wonder sometimes in this whole story, you know, why didn't God just pass over this character flawed Saul and just jump straight over to David? He could have done that. He could have, you know, he could have had David do it from the very beginning. I mean, Saul's 42-year reign just really caused misery for so many people. Now, I let God off the hook about that question by saying that, you know, God had a plan, he had a big picture that we can't see. Somehow his plan had to include Saul so that God could end up accomplishing his desired results. And that is really what I do believe. But still, it doesn't seem right. It doesn't seem fair. It seems like an unnecessary response on God's part. Such is life. Isn't it true that there are times where, you know, something doesn't seem right or fair or seem unnecessary, but it happens? Isn't it true that even in our relationship with God, there are times where how he treats us or the things he allows doesn't seem right, doesn't seem fair, doesn't seem necessary? Now, going back, when I was, the last time I was reading in 1 Samuel, it was back in December. And I practice journaling. And so that means that when I'll be reading a passage of scripture, then I will begin to kind of journal and kind of free writing. I'm not worried so much about grammar or anything like that. You know, what is God saying to me? And then I write, how does this speak to me? And I write it out. And then as I look at that and think about that and reflect upon it, then it'll lead maybe to more insight. And I begin to write these things out. And then sometimes what I'm writing out will lead me into a time of prayer about whatever it was I was writing. Let me share with you, three things that I wrote down in my journal when reflecting upon this passage of Scripture. The first thing I wrote was, when things seem to be unraveling around me, I must be careful about taking matters into my own hands. See, taking matters into your own hands often means that you're taking matters out of God's hands. And I just wonder how many times God has a plan, but because I step in too quickly to take control, I never really have the opportunity to see God move. Now, of course, let me give you an example. You might be thinking, there must be exceptions to this. Well, sure. For example, if you and I were taking a let's say, a hike up in the mountains, which would never happen. I don't hike. I don't like to camp. The problem is some of my kids, they like to camp. Hey, Dad, don't you think it would be fun if we all got together and we all went camping as a family? I said, no. If there's a hotel near the campground, I won't. But let's just say that you and I are taking a hike up in the mountains and you're about to walk over a cliff. I'm not going to sit there and say, well, let's see what God does. Don't intervene too close. Maybe God won't, you know. I don't mean to be too funny here, but you know, like if somebody, you know, that you're with is having a heart attack, you call 911, you don't pray. You call 911, then you pray. I was talking to a client, I remember I worked with pastors. I was talking to a client once. While we were talking, he started having a heart attack. I could recognize what he was saying. I said, are you okay? He said, oh, no, I don't think it's anything. You know, I feel like there's a tight, you know, band tightening around my chest. I have a little bit hard to breathe. You know, I'll be okay. I said, I think we need to get off the phone. I think you need to call 911. Well, I'll be okay. I'll do that after we're done talking. I said, no, you won't. You get off the phone right now, buddy. Sure enough, he went to emergency. They brought him in triple bypass. He'd be dead today. But it wouldn't have been right, you know, for me to, you know, just say, well, I'm not, that doesn't sound good to me, but I'm not going to say anything, because who knows, maybe God wants to move, you know. You see, I'm telling you, the exceptions to it. We're not being, you know, ridiculous in here. I can't remember, Bill, and I think it was just like a few years after we moved up here. We're into our ninth year, I think, of living here. I can't remember, it wasn't too long after we moved here, but I don't know if I lost a lot of clients because, you know, I make my living by coaching pastors. You know. And I can't remember if I lost a number of clients or what it was, but all of a sudden we were down $500 a month. Like that. Now, I don't know about you, but I can't recover from $500 a month. $100, I can probably get by, you know, something. You know, like that. And I was panicking. In my mind at the time, the only option we had was to sell our house. Mm-hmm. And I said, I, this is it. This is it. Right, Holy Spirit has come upon me. We're gonna just sell our house. Made complete sense. Ellen says, and we talked about it, and we kind of said, yeah, I think it, you know, which wasn't true. I think that's what's going to happen. So we were kind of like on the verge of setting that whole process in motion. And Ellen says to me, you know, I've just been kind of thinking, why don't we just wait a little bit and just see what God does? And you know, at least I don't think I said this. But in my head, I'm thinking, are you crazy? You know, as we're waiting for what God's going to do, we're going to get deeper and deeper and deeper in trouble. You know. But she goes, I don't know. I mean, yeah, we might have to sell our house, but maybe God will supply for us miraculously. I said, okay. You know. And I don't know how many months it was. It was a few months where my financial situation didn't change. I didn't build up my client base to make up for that. But you know what? For 3 months, we saw an extra $500 come in miraculously. It wasn't like someone wrote a single check. It was a little bit here, a little bit there. I get hired to do this, get hired to do that. And in the end, God supplied $500 a month, you know. But we probably, you know, would have never experienced that if we had just said, got to sell the house. You know, see, that's an example of taking matters into our own hands. That's the first thing I wrote in my journal. Here's the second thing I wrote in my journal. I wrote down that I need to seek the Lord and draw near to the Lord during good times and the quiet times, so that when the pressure comes from the challenging times, I have built up a reserve of good that will come out of me during that time of pressure. Somebody once said that trials build character. I don't think that's true. I think trials reveal character. And then maybe after what's revealed, then maybe a character might shape or something or get better or anything. And this is why I believe that there was something going on below the surface of Saul's life that we don't know about, but that God did know about, and the pressure of the advancing enemies, the pressure of seeing his people begin to leave him and his soldiers slipping away, brought out this foolishness and recklessness, this lack of faith, this disobedience. It wasn't just God overreacting. And then here's the third and final thing that I wrote in my journal in reflecting on this chapter. That I've got to grow comfortable with waiting. Anybody have a problem with waiting? Now, it's easy for me to be critical of Saul, to read this story and say, you dummy, if you only waited 5 minutes, I bet you that would have been enough time for Samuel to come walking around the corner, and none of this would have happened. But the truth of the matter is, I don't always wait to see what God is going to do. I don't always wait before I speak. I don't always wait before taking action that makes sense to me. I don't always wait for an answer from heaven. You know what? I think that if I had been in Saul's shoes, I would have done the very same thing. I think I would have. Well, here's the conclusion. And I just realized that I don't think I turned my microphone on, did I? They're back there going, died on the top of Mount Gilboa fighting. to kill him once. But at the very end, who's up on the mountain, side by side, shoulder to shoulder, father and son? And they go down together. And from that moment on, then David takes over. And as you begin to study the life of David, this is interesting. We discover that David, you know, we always think, David was so great. He was the man after God's own heart. But when you study the life of David, he did just as many bad things as Saul had done. I haven't counted them up, but if you draw up a list of all the stupid, sinful, and disobedient things that Saul did, David did just as many things like that. What was the difference? The difference between David and Saul was that we know that David was a man of prayer and a worshiper of God. We know that David was the type of person that would admit when he was wrong. And we know that it was David's habit to come humbly and sincerely to God asking for forgiveness. We see no evidence of those traits in Saul's life. I think that's what made the big difference between King Saul and King David. So, what have we learned today? We've learned that we've got to be careful about taking matters into our own hands. When it's not that even like what we do could be a wrong thing, it's just that when we take matters into our own hands too quickly, it makes you wonder how many times we just missed out on seeing God doing something miraculous. Number two, when pressure comes, whatever is in you has a tendency of coming out of you. Therefore, I've got to make sure that during the quiet times, when things are kind of going okay, that I'm filling myself up with prayer, reflecting upon God's word, kind of stuff like that, so that when the difficult time comes and you squeeze me, that's what comes out. And then finally, and I get the impression we all can relate to this, gotta learn to be comfortable with waiting. It's not only a part of life, but it's a part of one's own spiritual development. People that grow spiritually, one of the things you find they have in common is they've learned to be willing to wait. Let's pray. Father, we bring those three things to you right now, and as a group, we admit that we don't always do good in those areas. And so we come, help us that we don't jump in and take matters into our own hands too quickly. We want to kind of give you an opportunity to move. Help us to not wait to cry out to you, you know, during the difficult times, but during the easy times, to cry out to you, to walk in obedience, to fill ourselves up with your word and prayer, things like that, so that when the pressure comes, good will come out. And Father, help us. We, by our very nature and the nature of our culture, we are an impatient people. Help us as followers of Jesus learn what it is to wait upon you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Would you please stand and turn to page 98 in your hymnals and join us in singing Great is Thy Faithfulness. And we'll be singing all three verses.
Mm-hmm.
Your mercies are new every morning. How we know we can trust ourselves, your presence, your power, your love to you. This morning, as we dedicate these gifts to you, these tithes, these offerings, taking from what you have given us, we just ask that you would use these gifts for your purposes, to do the work of your church, to do the work of building your kingdom, carrying forward your mission across this world. And we just pray that you would take all of it, and that your will be done. We love you, we praise you, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
guide each one of us as we enter into this new year together as a church. Lord, we thank you for your incredible faithfulness, your incredible love for us, and for all that you have done and are doing and will do. And through it all, we know that you are worthy not only of our worship, but of our trust, of our faith. And so we do put our trust in you. And all this, Lord, we pray the prayer that your son Thomas saying, our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come,
thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Singing Love Divine, All Loves Excelling on page 21, and we'll be singing verses 1, 2, and 4.
Seeking the Lord in all things. We Palestinian people. It really boils down to that. May we be a people of faith, a people of trust in the Lord, waiting on Him as we see Him at work, following Him and joining in what He's doing. Towards that end, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of our Heavenly Father, the presence and the power of the Holy Spirit be with us all.
Amen.